Kings Island Family Entertainment Center, located just outside of Cincinnati, Ohio, is jam-packed with people who have come to watch Evel Knievel, the professional life risker, the daredevil, however you like to say it. Evel Knievel, out of retirement, and they have come from all parts of the country. They're in campers, they're in trucks, they're on motorcycles, they're on pickups, and they have watched as Evel Knievel made practice jumps this afternoon over 10 Greyhound buses. His jump this afternoon, perhaps one of the longest of his life, is going to be over 14 Greyhound buses. An enthusiastic crowd, as you always have whenever Evel Knievel is there. It's a happening. The weather, well, it has not been good. It's cloudy, it's overcast, it's windy, it's gusty, and last night it rained, and there was a threat for a moment that jump would not take place. Hello, I'm Frank Gifford. Back with Evel Knievel as we were in London last May to the 26th. Evel Knievel, of course, missed on that jump. He went for 13 double-deck London buses, and if you saw that show, you know he made 12 and a half and was injured. He suffered a compression fracture of his spine. He broke his hand. He had a deep concussion. He said right after that, I will retire. But I was there at the time. In fact, I was holding him up when he said he was never going to jump again. Of course, he was in shock. He spent weeks in the hospital there. He came back, changed his mind for whatever reasons are Evel Knievel's. But indeed, Evel Knievel is back, and he's going to jump. You have to ask yourself and wonder, why is Evel Knievel back jumping? And that's what I ask him.
The reason that I want to jump the buses again is that I quit under the worst of circumstances. When I got up, I was awake and conscious. I knew my pelvis and my back were broken. I knew that I was hurt internally. I felt it. I just gave up completely because I didn't want to go through it anymore. You can't do it and say you're the best in the world and then fall off and get up and say, I quit. Not if you're an Evel Knievel, you can't. And I'm not going to quit that way. I will try it again. If I make it, I'll continue. And if I don't, I'm going to pack it all in.
Evel Knievel, as he talked to us a few weeks ago, referring to return to action. There is the span of the 14 buses Evel Knievel will jump this afternoon. He's in the dressing room at the moment in his van situated just up the course of the jump, preparing to go for the jump. That, of course, coming up on Wide World of Sports. Also today on Wide World of Sports, the Harlem Globetrotters. You've enjoyed them in the past, the zany antics of the Harlem Globetrotters.
This, of course, is the White House, Washington, D.C., the national capital. And on the lawn in front of the White House, the Harlem Globetrotters performing just a tiny part of their famed antics. And then, Landover, Maryland. The Magic Circle, as done by the Globetrotters, the most famous scene in their repertoire. For this whole occasion, the visit to the White House, and then a game coming up, well, it was probably one of the most memorable moments in the career of the Harlem Globetrotters as a unit. The Magic Circle. Look at the movements. Impeccable and as flamboyant as ever. As the Globetrotters prepared before a delighted crowd to do battle with their opponents. All of this seen earlier this year on ABC's Wide World of Sports. And the opponents with a secret weapon, the Washington Generals.
The globe to bring you the constant variety of sport, the thrill of victory, and the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. This is ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Brought to you by Lincoln Mercury. See all our 76 cars with their new EPA mileage estimates. We're proud of them at the sign of the cat. And by Sears, home of the road handler. The next step in Sears steel-belted radio.
Stay State Farm agent, Ray Bernard.
As I say, the only thing we sell is service. The least thing I can give is to be nice along with that service. And when it gets to where I can't be just as nice to someone when they come in with a problem or with a claim as when they come in to buy insurance, then I better get out of the business or take a few days off.
And like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
This is a Motorcraft tune-up kit. In tests supervised by an independent testing company, Motorcraft points, condensers, and auto lights spark plugs were installed in 155 Ford, Chevy, and Plymouth taxis to find out how tough they really were. After 3 million tough taxi miles, less than 1% of the parts couldn't take the punishment. When your car needs a tune-up, get Motorcraft quality auto parts from Ford. Taxi tested tough.
Kings Island, just outside of Cincinnati, Ohio, the home of the world champion Cincinnati Reds. And here at Kings Island, thousands of people have gathered for the jump of Evel Knievel. An incredible crowd. Considering the weather, it was raining this morning. The jump looked like it was going to be postponed. However, the jump is on. Evel Knievel has been practicing this afternoon, has already turned on this crowd, excited them. There are the 14 buses which Evel Knievel will be jumping very shortly. Earlier today, he jumped 10 buses, seemed satisfied. As we said, excited the crowd, has gone back into the van, will be out very shortly, and will be warming up his bikes and doing as only Evel Knievel can do to a crowd, getting them excited, turned on in every possible way. Hello again, I'm Frank Gifford, and once again with Evel Knievel, a man that I've come to know over the past few years. He's unique in every way. One thing I would like to say, and I really only paraphrase what Evel Knievel has said so very many times, and that is, he is a professional life risker. He is a daredevil. He has been doing this from a very early age, many, many years involved. And I would like to say that to the young people who are watching this show today, never try to do what an Evel Knievel does, because it can be dangerous, it can be deadly, as a matter of fact, and it should not be attempted. Evel Knievel has said that so many times himself, and I just want to reiterate it for him. I'm sure he'll say it again. But Evel Knievel is a very special man. Last May 26th, we were in London. He was jumping 13 London buses. He jumped 12 and a half London buses. He went down, tumbling end over end off the landing ramp, and he came out with very serious injuries, a compression fracture of his spine. He had a broken right hand. He had a concussion. And in the shock of it all, as he went back onto the grandstand, which was amazing in itself, because he insisted on walking back up there to almost apologize to the 80,000 fans in Wembley Stadium in London for not having made the jump that he said he would make. He walked back up that ramp, and in apologizing in a way to the crowd for not accomplishing what he said he would do, he also said, "This is my last jump." Of course, he was in shock. As a matter of fact, I was helping the man off the ramp. I know the look of shock in Evel Knievel was in bad shape at the moment. After weeks in the hospital, he returned home, changed his mind, and you heard earlier his reasons for returning to jump. He is unique in every way, Evel Knievel, the man out of Butte, Montana, and as always, he turns on a crowd wherever he is. He has been here for a few days practicing, supervising the setup, and we understand he is about ready to make his appearance. And here he comes right now, Robert Craig Knievel. Evel, welcome to Kings Island.
Thank you.
Good crowd.
Ready to go. Looks like there's enough of them to blow me over it if I can't get that Harley Davidson over it.
The wind, we'll talk about that again, Evel. Gusting, a problem?
Well, it looks from the side of the flags that it may have died down a little bit, but I'm going to go, Frank. There's no wind going to stop me, not even a hurricane.
Evel, your estimation of the speed it might take to clear the 14 Greyhounds?
Well, I don't know what the speed will be. I know we got the proper gearing on the thing. Roger Riemann's here. He's tuned the bikes for me for years. The machine is ready. I made it over 10 twice, and I know I can do 14.
Good luck, Evel.
Thanks, Frank. I'll make it. I'll see you when it's over.
Evel Knievel now will make his way over to the approach ramp, to the jump. He will make the long walk. He will hear the roar of the crowd. This man has developed really his own cult over the years. People, as we said, have come from all over the country for this jump. An incredible career, if you can call daredeviltry a career. Evel Knievel began in the rodeo. He was a fine hockey player, played semi-pro hockey, started his daredevil antics with a group, then separated, went out on his own, and has been jumping motorcycles for years. He suffered many injuries. We spoke to his personal physician in Butte, Montana. This past summer, he has had over 50 fractures. Of course, the most incredible crash that he ever took was at Caesar's Palace in 1968. That, of course, over the top of Caesar's Palace. And now he is about ready, as he customarily does, to address the crowd.
Thank you. Thank you very much. On behalf of my sponsors, the Chuckles Candy Company, Greyhound, AMF Harley-Davidson, I'd like to thank all of you for coming here with ABC's Wide World of Sports to one of the finest places that I have ever had the privilege to perform in my life. It's a thrill, it's a privilege for me to be here at Kings Island. It's the best place that I've ever in my life had the cooperation, the help, the enthusiasm, and the feeling from everybody that works here to help make this one of the safest and the best performance that I've ever had a chance to give. I'd like to ask a favor of you before I get on with the jumping. The Indianapolis race car drivers take a few practice laps before they race at Indy. The motorcycle racers take a few practice laps before they run at Daytona, Ontario. And I'd like to get warmed up before I make the jump. I'd like to do some wheelies for you. Would you like to see some wheelies? Okay. Also, for the first time here in the United States, since the rain has stopped, and since I feel that it's safe enough, I'd like to have my youngest son, Robbie, come up. I'd like to have him do some wheelies with me. Robbie? Put your helmet on. Robbie's 13 years old. He's been riding a motorcycle for 8 years. He started when he was 5. And we enjoy having a lot of fun and riding together. We use more than extreme caution when we're riding where there's automobile traffic. And we try and do the right thing and the safe thing when it comes to riding a motorcycle. Right now, we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to do some wheelies for you. We'll do them on both sides here so that everybody can get a chance to see. I know you know that it's a little tight on this side where the buses are, but we'll try and get the job done. Let's go and have some fun, do some wheelies. Come on.
Evel Knievel walking down the ramp with his son Robbie. He's 14 years old. And we'll be back at Kings Island, Ohio, in just a moment.
Radio Shack has the perfect answer for anyone who hasn't bought a telephone answering system because the price was $99 to $150. Well, for 2 weeks only, you can buy Radio Shack's Duophone telephone answerer for just $59.95. Answers in your own voice and tapes the caller's message so you never miss another phone call again. The sale price Duophone answering system, only at Radio Shack, a Tandy company.
One way I can help you hold on to your car is to give you a battery you can hold on to. DX True Blue. It's so good, DX will back it up for as long as you own your car. If True Blue ever fails to hold a charge in your present car, DX will replace it free with proof of purchase, as long as it hasn't been damaged by accident or abuse. So as long as you sit behind that wheel, I'll stand behind my battery.
True Blue, full lifetime warranty.
As Evel Knievel with his son Robbie, he's 14 years old, as you heard Evel Knievel say earlier to the crowd here. They try to observe every possible safety measure that you can. And Evel, as I said before, is very strict about safety measures on a motorcycle. I was with him in London riding in a car towards Wembley Stadium when he stopped the car, got out of the car, and walked over to two youngsters who were parked at a stoplight. They did not have helmets on, and he really chewed them out. Said, never get on a bike without a helmet. And of course, this he has brought to his family. His other son, Kelly, in Butte, Montana, watching hopefully the show today. There he walks over to have a word with Robbie. Cindy, his daughter, is here in Kings Island. Robbie Knievel, 14 years old. Here's Raleigh Eastwick. He's in the, he's to your right. And, of course, Will McEnany, the two relief stars of the Cincinnati Reds. They're out here to watch Evel Knievel today, and what a great World Series we've had. They were in the truck with us prior to the opening of the show, and they were fascinated. They kept asking me questions. What kind of a man is Evel Knievel? That's a very difficult thing to answer. We did an hour special with him this past summer. I came away, as I said in the show, with more questions than I arrived in Butte, Montana with. Father and son. Evel Knievel's wife, Linda, is also here. She's an Evel Knievel's fan, along with his beautiful daughter, Cindy. They're quite a family. Have a beautiful home in Butte, Montana. Tracy, as I said, is with her mother, observing the happening from Evel Knievel's van. Wheelies! With the three of his children, Kelly and Robbie and Tracy. And particularly with anything that pertains to a motorcycle. They never would dare go near one without a helmet. We have taught them all kinds of safety measures in riding the bicycle. And again, if you'll notice on all the approved helmets you've ever seen a motorcycle rider with, they have that DOT stamp. That comes from the Department of Transportation, and they set up a code. And Evel, of course, as I mentioned before, he sees somebody riding a motorcycle without a helmet, he's out of his car or off his bike and is really all over them. And we found out about that, and we learned that there are good helmets and there are bad helmets. And obviously the most important protective device a motorcycle rider can wear is the helmet. And in March of 1974, the Department of Transportation brought about a federal law. It's called the Federal Motor Vehicle Safety Standard number 218. And this means that helmets have to go through certain tests, three tests as a matter of fact, under four conditions. They must stand up to these tests if they are to be sold for road use. There, of course, is extreme heat. As you see here, helmets being heated to extreme temperatures. There are extreme cold temperatures applied. Helmets frozen, actually. And there is, of course, room temperature. And then the helmets are soaked in water. And then they go through the three tests. The chin strap, of course, is most important.
because no matter how much how well the helmet is constructed, if it doesn't stay on, it doesn't make any difference. And the chin strap must withstand a pressure of 300 pounds. And then, of course, the most important part of the helmet is that the blow, if there is to be a blow, be distributed throughout the helmet so that it is not concentrated in one area of the head. This test, over a measured distance, the helmet is dropped on an instrument. The helmet has a wire that will go to an oscilloscope, and it will record how the blow is distributed throughout the helmet. And of course, by just watching, you can't tell how the helmet is standing up. But there you see the wire. It goes to the oscilloscope, and this is recorded, indicating how the blow was distributed. As you can see, there was no severe shock in one area. Now let's take an inferior helmet. You'll see the difference, and it's rather dramatic. There it is. On your left, the inferior helmet, the proper helmet on the right. There's a penetration test that is also given.
Thanks very much.
An instrument driven against the helmet to see if the instrument will penetrate not only the outer lining, but the inner lining as well. All these helmets, of course, lined throughout. This helmet stood up well. Now an inferior helmet that does not come up to the standards, and you can see the difference. Of course, there are other stickers which indicate proper safety standards for the helmet. The Snell Foundation and the Safety Helmet Council of America, they conduct random tests in stores and in manufacturing plants, and those, of course, just for further protection. And we'll pick up Evel Knievel talking to this crowd about the helmet.
In this country, in years to come, because of the energy crisis that we have, because of the transportation problem, I hope that an honest effort for motorcycle safety will be introduced into our educational systems in schools in this country through a responsible United States Congress. And I hope further that I will be able and have been able to make a contribution to that program, one that young Americans will take heed of. Now I'd like to show you a car that I had built in Detroit by a friend of mine, Carl Casper. It's absolutely the finest wheelie car in the world. Would you like to see some wheelies in an automobile? Okay. I'm a little contained on this side, but I'll do the best that I can, and I hope you enjoy them. Thank you.
So Evel Knievel moves off the landing platform, and we'll be returning to Kings Island in just a moment.
This guy happens to be successful. Very successful. And he looks it. You can bet that his hair isn't dry, stiff, or wild-looking. His hair looks healthy, alive, naturally terrific. Because he uses this natural conditioner every day. Brill Cream, regular or new anti-dandruff. Just a little dab of Brill Cream is the natural way to make success go to your head.
This is the tire we ran on top roads around the world. And here's the next step in steel-belted radials from Sears. Road Handler. With wider radial design than the tire that tamed the mountains of Morocco. Road Handler. With more steel guts than the tire that beat the Baja. Road Handler, with better wet cornering traction than the tire that ran East Africa. Wider radial design, more steel. Road Handler, only at Sears.
We're looking at a new wrinkle for Evel Knievel. He's off his motorcycle. He's into a specially designed wheelie car. And he is going to demonstrate the wheelies on a four-wheeled vehicle. You just saw a short while ago the wheelies on his motorcycle, and also by his 14-year-old son, Robbie. And here's Robbie. Robbie moving away from the van. And once again, if you young people are watching, you should not be trying to duplicate the feats of Evel Knievel, or I could say his son at this point, because they have practiced for years, they've worked hard at this, and it's something that is very dangerous and could be very deadly. Evel Knievel warming up his wheelie car. Uh,
down to the our camera left. That's the runout ramp that you see going out onto the superhighway that bypasses Kings Island. Evel Knievel has come up with some other strange vehicles in his time. I'm referring, of course, to the Sky Cycle, in which he made the Snake River Canyon attempt, and now the wheelie car. It's a bit more like a yo-yo. People have continued to pour in here to Kings Island. It was thought this morning the jump would be canceled because of rain. However, a grandstand has been built here in the past 15 days. It seats 35,000. There is standing room area for 35,000 more. More wheelies in the wheelie car by the 37-year-old Robert Craig Knievel. That's the plywood runout ramp that he's crossing. And he will make another pass in front of the grandstand side, where there's some 35,000 seats have been placed. Wheelies in the wheelie car. And of course, this crowd is here waiting for one moment when Evel Knievel launches himself off his launching ramp to hurdle over the 14 Greyhound lines, and that will be coming up shortly.
How do you spell relief?
When I have heartburn, I spell relief R-O-L-A-I-G-S.
For acid indigestion, I spell it R-O-L-A-I-D-S.
Rolaid spells relief. In this test with Rolaid's active ingredient, laboratory acid changes color to prove Rolaid's consumes 47 times its weight in excess stomach acid. How do you spell relief?
For gas, I know R-O-L-A-I-D-S.
Rolaid spells relief.
Monroe brings the incredible lifting power of air down to solid ground. With Monroe Max Air, air adjustable shock absorber. Heavy-duty shock absorbent. And when you need extra lift, just add air. It's like having an extra set of springs whenever you need them. Provide the air. Monroe Max Air. Monroe. First in shock, you'll feel the difference.
Tonight on Saturday Night Live, these great Chinese acrobats of Taiwan, Kate Smith, La Belle, John Biner, highlights of Evel Knievel's daredevil jump. Live from SeaWorld in San Diego, Soupy Sales and marathon swimmer Diana Nyad attempt to ride Shamu the killer whale. And other surprises tonight, Saturday Night Live with Howard Cosell here on ABC.
Back at Kings Island, Evel Knievel roaring down in front of the standing room crowd and showing him his new wheelie. Knievel always seems to come up with another gimmick to turn a crowd on. And this man has been doing this for years. And apparently he'll make one more pass. There it is. Will McAmini and Raleigh Eastwick are standing by with their jaws almost open. They're fascinated by this man. They were asking everyone around here, what kind of a man is he? Now Evel is going to go back up to the runout ramp once more. Once more he will be addressing the crowd. And this, of course, is a custom of Evel Knievel. Moving up towards the 14th bus.
Thank you. I'm going to run about 175 on the straightaway on a nice smooth track. I'm looking forward to getting it out on a good drag strip and getting those seat belts on and getting that helmet on and having some fun with it.
Right now, Roger Riemann, my dad Bob, all the Greyhound crew, and all of the fellas here at Kings Island that have worked so hard on this jump have given me the all clear sign that it's time to go, that the jump is ready, that the runways are in place. And since we don't have any threat of rain right now, I'd like to ask you fellas that are here working with me from Kings Island, you can go ahead and remove the plywood runway that you built for me that goes out into the Ohio Turnpike or the freeway. You can go ahead and take that off. I think the jump now would be safer without the plywood runway. Thanks for the help. You know, when I missed this jump in London over 13 buses, I said that I would never jump again. I said that I was through. I'm not a quitter. When you're down in life, you have to realize that life goes on and that you too have to go on, that you have to get up, that you have to keep doing it, whatever your chosen profession is that you might do yourself. I have done a lot of jumping in 10 years. I had a dream. I had a desire. I did a lot of practicing. I used a lot of caution. That's what you have to do to make a jump like this. And on top of it, you have to be a good professional, and you have to have faith in the men that are working with you. So with all of those things, with all of those years, you watch me make the best jump and the safest jump of my life. I'm ready to go.
Evel Knievel.
Evel Knievel will now pace off the landing ramp, double-checking everything as he always does. He is just about ready and will return to Kings Island in just a moment.
A Sears diehard. The battery you've seen start five cars is now on sale. Right now, you can save $7 on the diehard. Now, only $37.95. Get the battery that lives up to its name, the diehard, and save $7 on sale nationwide. Only at Sears.
Come on, Jimmy.
As an old offensive end, I usually don't have much use for running backs. But I've got to admit, Matthew was right when he told me about light beer from Miller. It is less filling. And light's got one-third less calories than their regular beer. And it really tastes great. In fact, after I teach this guy a lesson, I'm gonna have another bottle.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Hundel Harrison fights for survival on SWAT, tonight at 9, 8 Central on ABC.
Kings Island, Evel Knievel warming up his Harley Davidson 750. That's his jumping bike that he has been using. The critical thing has always been the gearing of this bike. And quite frankly, I'll tell you, my heart is pounding.
I was in London when he crashed, trying to jump the 13 buses. This is a moment that is difficult for anyone to go through that gets close to this man. He's unusual, he's unique. He's warm, he's charming. There's his father, Mr. Knievel. That's John Hood. And his father, giving him a pat on the hand, saying, good luck, son. There he goes. He will make several runs along the approach ramp. We never quite know when he will go or when he won't. He won't go until everything is exactly right. And again, if I could, just take this moment, as Evel has done so many times in the past, just we'd like to say that if you're watching this show and you have any information whatsoever to try any of the stunts that Evel Knievel has tried over his career, please forget it. He has said, as I have mentioned before, he is a professional life risker. And that is what is on the line when you attempt to do what Evel Knievel has done. He has also paid the price many times over. We have told you that. Over 50 fractures. And there is one of the prices Evel Knievel paid, almost his life, when he failed to go over the Snake River Canyon. The parachute deployed, he could have either gone into the Snake River and drowned or been hung up on the cliffs and crushed as the craft tumbled down that cliff. I'm standing with a couple of great athletes, and I'm just going to get a quick comment first from Raleigh Eastwick of the Cincinnati Reds. Raleigh, what do you make of this man?
He's got to be an unbelievable human being to do the things that he does, and to have so many fractures and to come back so early and be able to do the things that he does. You break so many bones. To break so many bones and come back so fast to do it again and not have any fear about it, that's just an unbelievable thing to me, you know. And
you guys came back pretty good, number seven.
Well, we didn't have any fear about it, so he doesn't have any fear about what he's doing, I guess, and that's the main thing.
Well, congratulations to you. Raleigh, and we'll have a word with Will in just a moment. Maybe I can get over and see if Evel has any thoughts about how the bike is doing. Now he's ready to go, and Will McEnany, your thoughts about this man?
I tell you, he's a real competitor. He's, I guess, more or less the same type of person as baseball players are. They have something to do, and they know what they're supposed to do, and just to go out and do it is something. But being able to jump over these 14 buses, he has to
really have
it myself, I don't think I would ever attempt to do it, and I admire the man for trying to do it himself.
Well, we admire you for your fine performance, too, in the series. I know you... We talk about Evel turning on a crowd. Well, what you have done to the city of Cincinnati with that tremendous reception they gave all of the Reds. Evel Knievel still warming up his bike, getting ready to go up on the ramp. Try and get a word with Evel Knievel's father. If he obviously is very concerned. And now he is moving away with the chief mechanic of Evel Knievel's. That would be Roger Ryman. He has been with Evel Knievel for many years, and there is the jump. And I tell you, when you look at it in that perspective, it really is kind of awesome. 14 Greyhound buses. The attempt in London, as we have said, was over 13 of the double-deck London buses. The crowd, of course, will rise with every move Evel Knievel makes, and particularly when he comes up the approach ramp. It's quite difficult to say when he will go. He'll make two or three approaches, looking out over that expanse. Difficult to estimate the distance that Evel Knievel will travel. He does not have a speedometer on his motor. He goes strictly by feel. He does not try and gauge the speed. He has estimated that he must be traveling somewhere between 85 and 90 miles per hour, but he doesn't really know. He has a runout ramp. The ideal position would be to hit the front wheel just a little above the rear wheel. The gearing of the bike is most important, and he has been having a lot of troubles here in the practice sessions at King's Island. Thank you.
again, another practice approach. Try and get a word with Roger Ryman, Evel Knievel's chief mechanic. He is talking right now with Evel Knievel's father. Roger, you have just a second to give us a quick thought. Are you happy with the running of the bike?
Boy, it's just running perfect. We can't ask for anything any better. Everything worked out good for us this morning. The Red Wing stuff is really working good that we've been using, and the motorcycle with Harley-Davidson motorcycle is the greatest thing in the world.
Well, good luck, Roger. I know how concerned you are. Just a quick comment from you, Mr. Knievel. Obviously, a lot of concern.
Well, everything is gold.
Okay, thank you, sir. I know how concerned you are, and I know also how proud you are.
I am very proud of you.
Thank you. All right, Evel Knievel has now approached the buses three different times. In London, he went over that jump, or made the attempt on his fourth attempt. He's talking now with John Hood, a very close personal friend who was with him in London, also a motorcycle mechanic, who has worked a great deal on Evel's bikes over the years. It's really difficult to say for sure whether Evel will go on this run or not. A man from Butte, Montana, began a life that could have led to imprisonment. He admittedly was a bad kid, as he puts it, and all of a sudden he said, I knew that the way I was going, I had to change, or I was in for a lot of trouble. Started out as a professional semi-pro hockey player, went into rodeo work, went into daredevil tricks, and we cannot tell you whether he will go this time out. No, he pulls up, and he will not go this time again. One more look. Of course, he has had many successful jumps, but he has had many that have not been so successful. There was a time in Carson City, Nevada, when he nearly suffered fatal injuries. And then, of course, that memorable jump at Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas in 1968. The thumb went up, indicating that this time it will be go. Again, John Hood is there with Evel Knievel, discussing whatever you discuss at this moment. Evel Knievel is very intense. We talked to him a few moments ago before he came out of the van. And his total concentration now is getting that bike off the approach ramp and onto the landing ramp. And he's not hesitating. He'll go.
Half,
boy, it did come apart, didn't it?
Boy, I hit hard.
Yeah, I know.
Man, oh, let me just flip around on this side.
Oh, where'd I land?
Just a little short.
Man. Number 14, I don't care. I'm
just a little short.
I did it, that's the way it is.
Well,
I almost came over backwards, but I'm walking away from it.
Great show.
Thank you, Dad.
Hey, Mo, can we talk to you about your thoughts?
Yes.
We can just turn you around to our handheld here.
All I can tell you is that
thank you. You know, I landed on number 14. I didn't get all the way across it. This motorcycle is the finest machine in the world as far as I'm concerned. It broke in half, but it held me up. And all I can say is thanks to number one, thanks to Harley Davidson. You've been so good to me through the years. I would like to tell all of you something, though, that I want you to take on a serious thought. You saw this motorcycle with the front end high in the air, and if a man is a real professional, he has to realize that He cannot go beyond the point of no return, and a motorcycle is not an airplane. It doesn't have wings on it. I am going to continue to perform throughout this country and throughout the world with my sons, and I hope that I'll be successful at doing it. But as far as I'm concerned, I have jumped far enough. Today, I'm going to walk away from here with you, and I hope to come back and see you here at Kings Island again. And I hope to walk back and walk away again for year after year after year. And I feel that's being a professional. That's what I'm going to do.
Evel Knievel addressing the crowd. We'll be back for a replay of the jump over the 14 buses, a successful one.
Thanks.
Evel Knievel has made it over the 14 buses. We'll try and get his further plans in a moment.
For years, a blindfold has stood for Lincoln Mercury's willingness to test its cars against tough competition in riding comfort and quietness, things you cannot see. This year, Lincoln Mercury spent millions on something else you cannot see.
A mileage boost program that has achieved a remarkable 29% average increase in the EPA mileage ratings for their 1976 cars over their 75s. Of course, your actual mileage may vary.
It takes a company with vision to make improvements you can't see.
Bank AmeriCard can make all the difference.
Abel, you have to be a little bit relieved. I know how tight you were, how tense you were, although you made some really good practice jumps this afternoon. We're going to take a look at it on the replay, and you perhaps tell us where it went right, where it went wrong. It never goes wrong when you make it, does it?
Well, Frank, you can see here the whole side of the motorcycle is busted up, and when I came off a takeoff, I was a little bit crooked. I tried to get straightened up. The horsepower dragged just a little bit, but boy, it came on strong. When I got up in the air, I felt the front end come just straight up and almost underneath me and go over backwards. And I thought, oh boy, the same thing's going to happen that happened. But look at that front end. I almost lost it, but boy, that suspension held. I lit right on top of that 14th bus and went on down and landed okay. And right there, I'm saying, boy.
We'll take another angle, another look at it from another angle, Evel, and
I don't think I've ever had the front end so high, Frank.
You and I'll see it, but at least our audience can see it. And it probably was the highest you've ever hit that front end with out.
I'd have gone another 3 feet. It looped over backwards on me, so I'm glad it came down when it did. You know, I hit the takeoff ramp. Roger Raymond is my tuner. He's one Daytona more than any man in the world, and Roger fixed this thing so to go as fast as it'd go. And he said to me before I left, remember, it's a motorcycle that don't have wings. It'll fly only as far as you can will it. And I'm glad it came down because it was just ready to come over backwards. But we hung on to it, and we got it done. And I've had some great help through the years, Frank, I'll tell you that.
Let's ask you one more time, Evel. Now, you said you would continue to jump, but you that's it in terms of distance.
I have jumped far enough. I don't, under any circumstances, want to jump any further. I will continue around the country with safety shows with these vehicles that I have, and I'll do everything that I can to try and make a contribution to the youth of this country. I think I have a tremendous responsibility, Frank, and
Have quite a following. Let's have a look at this, Evel. What is this, a little artistry that you've come up with?
This gas tank was done for me by a friend of Roger's named George Sedlak. You can see the chuckles and the $200 bills, and the gas tank says, are you man enough, big and bad enough, and color me lucky and evil, and Harley Davidson's on it, and I'll tell you, I'm very proud of it. He did color it lucky, and I made it okay.
Indeed you did. Roger, I had just a chance to visit with you just before the jump. You got to be proud of the happening.
Well, I am, Frank. Everything went the way we wanted to. We kind of broke the back of the motorcycle a little bit, but
I'm tougher than this iron, Roger.
I have to tell you that.
We got to take one more look at it. Evel, do you want to see it one more time from this other angle?
Look here. It got a little bit crossed up on takeoff because of the power. But there it comes past that Eiffel Tower, and down she goes. And boy, I'll tell you, it landed with that front end on that number one. I couldn't have asked for a more perfect jump. Frank,
it was
a
beauty.
I'm satisfied. I don't want to do it again. If you missed it,
and I don't want to watch you do it again.
Frank, I'd like to say something before we get off the air. You've been a friend and a great
guy for my backbone when maybe I didn't have it. I want to thank you personally for it.
Glad to be with you.
Okay, Frank. Thank you.
We'll be returning to Kings Island very shortly, but right now, let's join the Harlem Globetrotters, an event that you have seen earlier. The zany antics of the Harlem Globetrotters. You have seen it earlier, but it's exciting and fun. Here's Howard Cosell.
Hello again, everyone. I'm Howard Cosell. Welcome as they practice right behind us to the magic of the Harlem Globetrotters. They're about to play their 12,000th game ever right here in Capital Center, Largo, Maryland. They've traveled in their time 94 countries, been to every great city in the world, met the greatest statesmen and people in the world. Today, for the first time ever, they had the privilege of meeting the President, the First Lady of the land, at the White House. Working with me today, the distinguished commissioner of the NBA, Walter Kennedy. Why? Because for 12 years of his life, he was the publicist for these Globetrotters, traveled with them, knows as many great anecdotes about them as anybody alive. And Walter, I mentioned the visit to the President today. I remember a time when you and Abe Saperstein and the late, great Deuce Tatum were in Algiers. Suppose, as an evidence of their anecdotal history, you detail that as quickly as possible.
Well, this was the first game we ever played in Algiers. We were told that there was a lot of anti-American feeling and to be careful. At the end of the first half of the first night of our schedule there, the crowd poured out of the stands, and we thought we were going to be mobbed. We looked around for someone with whom to fight to death. I wound up with Abe in the middle of the court with Goose Tatum alongside of us, and the promoter came over and said, "Don't be afraid, don't be afraid, they just want to touch you." And Abe looked at me, and he looked at Goose, and he said, "Here I am, a Jew from Chicago, you an Irish Catholic from Connecticut, and Goose an Arkansas Baptist. Where could it happen but in American sports?"
One of the many stories about the Globetrotters in the memory log of Walter Kennedy as we await the start of the action, the Trotters against the Washington Generals. Center number 33, Dave Lateen. 36, of course, the Clown Prince, the Meadowlark Lemon. 23, Jackie Gent Jackson out of Virginia Union.
All right, all right.
14 is Bobby Joe Mason from Bradley and the Baldwin. 22, Curly Neal from Johnson City, from Charlotte, North Carolina. That was the familiar weave of the Globetrotters. Call it the wizardry of the hardwood, if you will. There they go again. And you saw the medal passing between his legs. The stuff shot by Jackie Jackson, Boys High School in Brooklyn, with his breeding ground.
All right, then, mean you. All right, JJ, get that ball back. Stop it! Stop!
You'll be hearing the Meadow, who is wired up throughout the course of the action. Off the boards is Dave Lateen with the ball. Now watch Curly Neal with his dexterity.
All right, then.
There he takes the pass off in for his score. Sometimes you wonder how these men get to where they do get so quickly, so artfully, and how the ball gets to them. General score. Of course, the score in a game like this isn't really significant. It's the performance that counts with the Globetrotters. Did you see that? And the stuff shot by Jackie Jackson. One of the things we want to do in this show is present the Globetrotters as human beings. Let's meet Jackie Jackson.
Does it somehow convey to you what it means to be a Globetrotter, that you are something more than just another professional basketball player?
Well, yes, I take it. You know, I have, over the years, you know, like, I watch the people in the stands and see the families, how close they are knitted together by coming to see us play. It's give me a special feeling in my heart that I'm doing something more than playing basketball.
Where'd you grow up?
In Brooklyn.
Bedford Stuyvesant.
Bedford Stuyvesant, right in the ghetto. That's the new word for it. I used to use the word slums.
Swiss boots. Your climbing equipment's got to be good. Chromoly pitons. I wouldn't trust anything else. Oh, yeah, razor. Wilkinson bonded. I bought it because the better the blade, the better the shave. And this Wilkinson bonded has one great blade. Hardest edge in the business, honed Wilkinson sharp. Precision designed, out, in. Wilkinson bonded shaves closer than my double edge did, and comfortable. Bonded razor blade from Wilkinson Sword. The better the blade, the better the shave.
Hi, I'm Walt Garrison, and I don't smoke, but I still enjoy tobacco.
Smokeless tobacco. Like gold here. Just a pinch between my cheek and gum, and I get full tobacco pleasure. And since I don't light up, I can use it doing almost anything.
Let's have them.
So go smokeless with Skoll, Copenhagen, or Happy Days Mint. The tobaccos you don't have to smoke to enjoy.
Back to the action at Capital Center in Largo, Maryland. The Globetrotters in their 12,000th game against the Washington Generals. And the Meadow with an obvious basket calls timeout. He must have done that trick 15,000 times. But still at this late date, many of the things he does are spontaneous.
I have to handle the ball before players resume. Meadow!
That's the way to tell it, Riley.
I call timeout! And I call time in.
You can't do that.
I just did it.
That's not legal. You can't do it. I have to handle the ball.
Riley Pickoff, the great grandfather of all time, controlling this game in his own indomitable way. Meadowlark Lemon testing vigorous.
Back to the action. You know, there was a famous referee who joined the Globetrotters even before Riley Pickoff. That was Pat Kennedy. Remember his story in Italy, Waller?
One night we were playing a game at Genoa in Italy in the Opera House because no basketball court was available. The court was on the opera stage, and we told Pat, be careful with the prompter's box, a hole in the floor. Pat fell in up to his shoulders, and it took three players to pull him out after 5 minutes of delay.
Let's get on out of here. Let's get on out of here. Out of here.
This is the Globetrotters' 49th season, and there's Curly Neal. Wizardry of the hardwood. That's what you've got to call that. The little red-headed fellow is Red Fox. He's over 50. Went to Villanova. He's the man who put the Washington Generals together.
Now, wait a minute. Paul Reagan, see your hair. Whoop, there you are. See your hair. Hey! We try.
The foul attempted murder.
Jason, what are you laughing at? Somebody could have been killed right down in there. And it could have been me. And I couldn't do this right here. Have you ever seen me, Shaker?
The man's as good an actor and comedian as he is a player. Uh-oh. Would you believe Riley Pickoff at over 60 got the moves of Muhammad Ali?
He used to be a jitterbug champion when he was a kid, Howard.
Oh, really?
In Philadelphia.
Hey! How many shots? Look, wait a minute, ref.
Otto,
give me four
Otto,
now.
Otto! He only gets one try. He got hit before he turns. Only one.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
I tell you, the people in this arena love the Globetrotters, but that's, of course, an old story. Oh, what timing! That's coordination!
All right, say, wait a minute.
Hey! Hold on! Shoot the ball, right?
Okay!
Hey! Shoot it, Frank, you know how.
And it goes.
Okay.
You ever wonder what kind of person Meadowlark Lemon is, really? That man out there who's always on stage performing? Well, I talked to him on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. Let's meet the Meadow.
You were hired as a ball player, not as a comedian. You knew nothing about what you were doing. How then did you become the symbol of comedy for the Globetrotters, become the great comedian that you are, as well as a great basketball artist?
Well, I practice in my room at night in front of the mirror. I practice before and after games, and we play every night, as you know. And I kept getting a little better, I imagine. Basically, I guess I'm a kind of a shy person, so I guess I had to work a little harder than a person like yourself.
How do you square the fact that you call yourself a shy person and yet you're the prime performer of one of the great international show business acts?
I don't know. I'm just a little
shy, a little introvert, I guess. And I knew what I wanted in life because this is a childhood dream come true for me. I didn't want to do any other thing other than become a Harlem Globetrotter. And from day one, when I saw the Harlem Globetrotters on a newsreel in Wilmington, North Carolina, at the Ritz movie house there, I knew this is what I wanted, and I had to work at it. At that particular time, I knew nothing about basketball. I began working, and, well, I got lucky.
That's extraordinary. How old are you?
Well, Howard, I'm between 18 and 100.
The electric power drill has one serious shortcoming. This nagging problem led us to develop this remarkable tool. It's light, yet powerful enough to handle most woods and compositions without plugging into any source of power. The Rockwell Cordless Power Drill.
This is the tire we ran on top roads around the world. And here's the next step in steel-belted radials from Sears. Road Handler. With wider radial design than the tire that tamed the mountains of Morocco. Road Handler. With more steel guts than the tire that beat the Baja. Road Handler. With better wet cornering traction than the tire that ran East Africa. Wider radial design, more steel. Road Handler. Only at Sears.
We cannot and we will not accept Soviet missiles in Cuba.
William Devane as President Kennedy. Martin Sheen as Robert Kennedy.
And the president will not tolerate this breach of trust, this act of war.
Howard De Silva as Nikita Khrushchev.
Are you prepared for war? Are you prepared for total destruction?
After you've watched the first 10 minutes, you'll know this is going to be one of the most incredible dramas you've ever seen. The Missiles of October.
Tomorrow at 9, 8 Central on ABC.
Well, the Globetrotters having a bad night tonight. They're really rolling over the Washington Generals. Larry Rivers of Missouri Western in action now, and he just made that score, number 11. Oh, the secret weapon is coming in for the Washington Generals. Number 8, it's Mungo Parrott.
Look at him. Hey, look at him. Hey. Hey, Curly.
Now,
I can't believe.
What's that?
I can't believe.
What is it?
What an absurd figure. Has anybody like Harris ever played against the Globetrotters before, Wallen?
Yes, Eddie Fisher, Sugar Ray Robinson, Burt Bacharach, and others like that.
Bacharach can write, Fisher can sing, Robinson can fight. What can Mungo do? Nothing, obviously. Did you see him miss that?
It'll never happen again.
I don't believe it, Alex. I do not believe it. All-State, Gary, Indiana. He was an All-State high school basketball player. Look what's become of that body.
Want me to get the ball? All right.
Come on, Indiana.
I'll get the ball.
Alex, don't play with the meadow. He'll destroy you.
Boy, from your wife, one standing there. Hot dog, here. Yes, ma'am, here. Get her. What you doing out there? Can I have it now? Can I have it now? All right. All right. Yes, sir. Yeah, yeah.
All right, that's a new one. I haven't seen that one. They come up with new tricks all the time. Absolutely fabulous.
Looking at it again in slow motion, all 5 members of the Trotters handle them all. That's what we mean by coordination, teamwork, timing, precision. This is some hack.
I'm gonna mind if you got you. Go on over there, Curly, babe. All right, there. All right, get on over there, Curly. Where are you? Where are you? I can't find Curly.
It's funny to even see Alex in the background there, isn't it?
You know, he moves pretty well for a big man. No wonder he had such mobility on the football field.
Oh, poor little red clots. Curly Neal and the Meadow give it to him. The Globetrotters at their very best tonight. We'll be back in a moment.
This is not Stuttgart, Germany. This is a test track in Michigan. The car, Mercury Monarch, an American answer to German engineering. The precision-sized Monarch has been engineered for American roads. Front suspension, fully independent. Hotchkiss rear suspension.
This year, tests like these show Monarch's ride is smoother than last year. This year, tests show Monarch's ride is quieter than last year. Over 100 pounds of body insulation to control noise in floor, roof, fenders, and trunk. Last year, Monarch was rated superior overall to a Mercedes 280 in 8 tests of handling and driving comfort by 41 out of 50 drivers. Mercury Monarch. Test one on your track. At the sign of the cat.
Matt Helm is trapped in the middle of a war tonight at 10, 9 Central on ABC.
Back to the action, Red Clots passing up to the secret weapon, Alex Karras, the nimble-footed tackle of yesteryear, throws to nobody. He hits the cape that serves to commemorate this occasion, the 12,000th game. Curly, Neil, and Mamedo are eating the cake off the ball. Charlie Pitkoff joins the action. The Globetrotters are loving every second of it, and for Alex, it has to be the most absurd moment of his life, Waller.
Karras always wanted to be a passer, no wonder they wouldn't let him.
Not like that.
Yeah, yes, we did. We ate the whole day.
That's got to be it. We ate the whole thing. A high point in the whole long history of the Harlem Globetrotters. Well, 12,000 games. We're celebrating tonight. That's what the cake was for, and only Alex Karras could have thrown the basketball into it.
Let's watch Alex as he tries to cover the meadow.
Now, Curly, look what Curly did to him. Never like this on the gridiron for the Golden Greek. Never.
Yes, he's the one that did it. Curly, that guy right there.
Raise your hand. Raise full pass.
Hey, I told you you did it. I saw you when you did it. I saw you when you did it in there.
This is the night when Alex Karras becomes a Buster Keaton.
Let that man alone.
That's right, Ralph. That's very good.
You tell him, Alex. Tell referee Pitkoff.
Let that man alone now.
I like him. I like him.
I want out.
No, they won't take Alex out. Red Clot's keeping him in.
Almost had
it. I kind of like you.
Alex getting into the mood of things.
Come on, get that ball, y'all. All right, all right.
Say to the truth, Waller, I'm just watching Alex. He seems lost there in the circle. You see him?
He'll wind up in the basket next if he doesn't watch out.
Oh, under the shirt and in. Meadowlark Lemon. The end of a fun-filled first half.
You want your electric razor to give you a better shave? Read your instruction booklet. Every leading manufacturer tells you. Right in the book they put with the razor. Use a pre-shave. And the one most everyone uses is Williams Electric Shave. Look, Electric Shave gets your beard to stand up.
so your razor shaves closer, smoother, and with less irritation. Get Electric Shave. Make your beard stand up. Make your razor shave better.
Do you think you've got it tough getting into shape? Think about a football. It takes a beating, and it's got to stay in shape. There's one that will, because it's made of rubber. And you know how rubber stands up to punishment. And get this, Voight sells more rubber footballs worldwide than any other brand. That's why AMF puts its name on the line, too. And that name adds even more value to sports products like Voight footballs. AMF brings out the best in you.
Well, this is Dave Dials back in New York City, and I'd like to remind you that today, right here in New York at Belmont Park, they had the 57th running of the Jockey Club Gold Cup, and in an upset, Group Plan the winner with Wajima second and Outdoors third. There was no show betting. Now, earlier this year on ABC's Wide World of Sports, we had the pleasure to bring you the Run for the Roses, the greatest horse race of them all, we think in this country anyway, the Kentucky Derby. We are now pleased to announce for the first time that right here on Saturday, November the 8th, we're going to bring you this country's classic international race, the Washington, D.C. International, featuring the richest horse racing field ever assembled. Now, France has entered $2 million winners, Dahlia and Ale France, and if he's once again healthy, it is hoped, certainly by us anyway, that Forgo will be able to race against those horses to continue his battle for the Horse of the Year honors with Wajima, who's also entered in that one. So be sure to join us on Saturday, November the 8th, for our exclusive coverage of the Washington, D.C. International from the Laurel Racecourse in Maryland on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Now let's move quickly to some football scores. Let's check the top 10. Ohio State played Purdue this afternoon. Ohio State the winner, 35-6. Archie Griffin did get more than 100 yards. He's now football's all-time rushing leader, more than 4,700 yards. Oklahoma in a rout, 39-7, overcoming 13 fumbles. There were 19 fumbles in all in that game. And third-ranked Southern California beat Notre Dame in South Bend. Tough to win there, 24-17. Ricky Bell, 165 yards and one touchdown. And Nebraska, number four, kept pace, beating 10th-ranked Colorado 63-21, 515 total yards. A reminder that next week, one of the games you'll see here on ABC is Nebraska and Missouri. That's at 12:30 Eastern time, to be followed by some regional games, including a California game. So stay tuned for that. Alabama playing hapless Texas Christian this afternoon. The 5th-ranked Crimson Tide rolled over TCU, the Horned Frogs, 45-0. Richard Todd scored a couple. Baylor played Texas A&M 6th ranked, and once again it was the defense for A&M. Lester Hayes, a defensive back, going 77 yards for one score. 19-10, A&M over Baylor. Michigan 55-7 over Indiana. Rob Lytle with four touchdowns for Bo Schembechler's Wolverines. Pointing up for that Ohio State game coming up here on ABC. Army and Penn State, the 9th-ranked Nittany Lions, the winner, 31-0. Woody Petchel with 139 yards and two touchdowns, his best game ever. Texas will play tonight. Let's check some other scores. First of all, let's move to the eastern sector of the country. Dartmouth and Harvard. Harvard the winner, 24-10. Cornell played Yale. Yale the winner in that, 20-14. Penn in an upset over Princeton, 24-20. Holy Cross edged Brown, 21-20. And Columbia lost for the 9th time in a row. Rutgers the winner by 41-0. Navy the winner over Pitt by a score of 17-0. Syracuse beat Boston College 22-14. Toledo beat Ohio University 14-10. The big game in the Mid-American Conference. Miami over Bowling Green by a score of 20-17. The first loss for the Falcons. Miami still undefeated in the MAC. Missouri beat Kansas by a score of 35-3. Another reminder that Missouri next week here. We'll be back with more Wide World, another look at Evel after this.
Hugh Johnson writing for Gourmet Magazine. Gallo Hearty Burgundy was the opening revelation of my California journey. Robert Lawrence Balzer, Holiday Magazine. Gallo Hearty Burgundy is the greatest value in red wine in America. Bruce Galpin, Washington Post. Gallo Hearty Burgundy would grace anyone's table. Judge it yourself. It's richer, more robust, the best of the Burgundies. Ernest and Julio Gallo's California Hearty Burgundy.
This is the tire we ran on top roads around the world. And here's the next step in steel-belted radials from Sears. Road Handler. With wider radial design than the tire that tamed the mountains of Morocco. Road Handler, with more steel guts than the tire that beat the Baja. Road Handler, with better wet cornering traction than the tire that ran East Africa. Wider radial design, more steel. Road Handler, only at Sears.
Is everybody happy?
You heard Nate Branch, number 32, say, is everybody happy? But I don't think everybody is, particularly Curly Neal. We've got the makings of a ruckus here with timeout on the court, because Nate just knocked a cup of water out of Curly's hand. Curly has just gotten another cup of water. And there, he answers back to Nate Branch, throwing the water squarely in his face. Now Nate's not getting any more. He's moving over across the court, heading right for a pail of water.
Oh, man, leave me with that water, man.
He's got it now. He's going to go after Curly. I've seen this kind of thing happen before. He's moving after Curly, ready to unload that water, which he does. But he hits Alex Karras. I'll tell you, Karras gets a drenching as if he hasn't suffered enough already tonight.
Howard, I don't know why you're poking fun at poor old Daddy. You got it pretty good in Memphis a couple of years ago, if I remember correctly.
I remember it very well. Now, Nate going after Curly with that basket full of favorites, deluging the viewers, the audience. I've got to tell you, Alex is taking it with much better grace than I did in Memphis. It came to me as a total shock. I'll tell you, one of the great things the Globetrotters do is somehow or other get the audience involved. Like this, Walter, two youngsters just plucked out of the stands.
This is part of the participation of the audience all over the world. You know, little kids love to be with the Globetrotters, and the Globetrotters love to do their thing with the little kids. Now, these are typical of what goes on all over the world.
Look at the youngsters' faces light up, Walter.
Holmes, get the other one home. Get the other one home. Get the other one home.
Oh, that makes those kids feel ten feet tall. Look at that.
This looks like we get a belt.
Autograph pennants go to the kids. Look at that youngster's face. Back to game action now. The familiar weave and the familiar talk from Meadow. But that kind of timing, that kind of coordination, one never quite grows accustomed to. So perfect is it. Look at that. Ball rolls up the arm, right into Curly. He puts it away.
There it goes, Meadowlark with his head passing the ball. Globetrotters use every means of communication. Feet, head, hands, body. Beautiful coordination and great teamwork.
You know something? There are nights in the NBA, and there are nights with the Globetrotters, Waller, when, you know, they don't have good shooting nights. There are nights, of course, when they have superb shooting nights. When you look at that hook shot, that's exactly what I mean.
Games come and go, but bowling is still one of the most popular sports. Almost 65 million men, women, and children enjoy the game. Many use a special ball. You only buy it at a pro shop or bowling center. It's got five stars and a great name rolling with it. Dick Weber. AMF puts its name on the line, too. And that name only goes on great sports products like the Dick Weber All-Pro Ball. AMF brings out the best in you.
Campbell's new chunky minestrone is like homemade.
Campbell's new chunky chili beef's more like homemade.
Chunky minestrone has chunks of vegetables, and it's seasoned with Parmesan cheese, like homemade.
Chunky chili beef has chunks of beef with kidney beans and real chili flavor, more like homemade.
Chunky minestrone is so chunky, you'll be tempted to eat it with a fork.
Same here, but I use a spoon to get every drop. Two new chunky soups,
like homemade.
This Monday on ABC's Monday Night Football, the Minnesota Vikings meet the Chicago Bears at Chicago's Soldier Field. The Vikings will be led by Fran Tarkenton, one of the NFL's all-time great quarterbacks, and all-pro running back Chuck Foreman. They'll be challenging the Bears' young defense, led by linebacker Wayman Bryant. That's NFL Monday Night Football, this Monday at 9 Eastern Time over most of these ABC stations.
Watch these guys. You wonder how good they really are. Didn't they once win a so-called world championship, Paula?
Well, it was more than a so-called, Howard. They really had a great basketball team some years ago. In addition to their playing prowess, they also developed, of course, these comedy antics that now are an integral part of their game.
Once they beat the Minneapolis Lakers when they were a real power.
Yes, that's right, in the Chicago World Professional Championship Tournament.
All right, then. Listen, wait a minute.
Poor Alex. Disconsolate and ridiculous figure, my colleague Mungo Garris presents. Nothing bothers Meadow Laughlin. I mentioned earlier that in counterpoint is a warm human being, a serious human being, a thoughtful human being. Let's go back to my conversation with him in front of the Lincoln Memorial.
How do you keep, after all of these years, your incentive, your zest?
Well, Howard, I don't like what I'm doing. I love what I'm doing. And I guess this helps, you know. A lot of times, you know, like, it isn't always the money that you work for. It's something because you really love it, you know. And this is the way I feel about what I do out there. I've had people say, well, how can you do it? Oh, man, you're putting yourself down. I've heard some athletes who got retired say, man, how can you do this? You know, like, you're putting yourself down. You're still a little boy. Okay, if you want to call me a little boy, it's all right with me. But I'm doing what I love in life, and this is what I love. This is what some of the older Globetrotters have left to me, and at least we can kind of keep the tradition going as long as we possibly can.
You don't feel anything you do is Uncle Tomish.
Essay. No way. Look, we're athletes and we're doing comedy. And anytime you can make people laugh at this, Uncle Tom, just think, Howard, if we could make the whole world laugh at one time, there would be no more wars.
The Harlem Globetrotters against the Washington Generals as the game nears its end. Always the presentation, as Meadowlark Lemon has emphasized, family entertainment, comedy. Like that and the merry-go-round. But Meadowlark isn't the only one who knows what the Trotters are all about. Bobby Joe Mason of Bradley University has similar feelings.
Have there been any moments when you've gotten sick and tired of the travel, been ready to throw it all in?
Yes, I'm glad you mentioned that, Howard, because there's been an incident happened to me that we were playing, and this little kid was watching the game. He had been afar, and his whole mouth had been burnt out, and he was sitting there. And I was getting ready to come out of the game and tell the coach, said, look, I'm tired, you know, because we've been, like, you play 7 nights a week, and I just wanted to sit down for a while. And as I came towards the bench, this kid was sitting there, and he was laughing. And I looked at him and said, how can you be tired, you know, to myself? How can I be tired when you got a little kid like that? Because it has all this happened to him. He's having a good time. So it just picks you up. You have things like it happen to us all the time.
Bobby Joe Mason of Bradley University. This is what's called the baseball routine. Walla, this is of long year standing too, isn't it?
Yes, and this kind of routine was put into the game to give the players an opportunity to get a little rest, because for many, many years, almost a half century, the Globetrotters have been playing, not only 7 nights a week, but 2 or 3 times on Sunday.
Which makes them even more extraordinary. You know what I'd like to bring out right now? You are now seeing the domestic contingent of the Harlem Globetrotters.
Internationally, there is another contingent doing the same kind of remarkable tricks with a basketball and the same kind of marvelous humor that we've had the privilege of watching tonight. And that international unit consists of the following men. Keith Austin, Marcus Haynes, the player coach, Theodius Lee, John Smith, Mel Davis, Jerry Venable, Ron Knight, Jimmy Blacklock, Jesse Jamison, and Twiggy Saunders. And our congratulations go to them, too. And to Stan Greason, the president of the Globetrotters. How do the people feel about the Trotters? I asked some of them.
Little Lark. He's the cutest thing I've ever seen.
They're wonderful. They're a wonderful team.
It's terrific. It really is. We really enjoy them. We were here last year and we'd come again.
They're remarkable.
Unbelievable. Fantastic.
I like to watch Karis also.
I couldn't agree with you more, sir. A gentleman with the dignified look possibly of a member of the United States Senate. But we're back to the action as we approach the conclusion of this game. And look at Meadowlark Lemon to the very end, giving his all, trying to entertain more than 15,000 people here at the Capitol Center tonight. The slick basketball wizard. Pass off and Curly Neal winding up with the basket. Look at that. Game just about to end. Hey, Meadow! There it is, Curly Neal. Let's try and get Meadow's attention. Hey, Meadow, what you think of the game?
The basketball gods are angry tonight.
You're looking at the mini Eiffel Tower, located at Kings Island, Ohio, where this afternoon, Evel Knievel did it again. It's almost eerie here now. The thousands of fans have found their way home, or forever, wherever they came from, because they have come from all over the country. Evel Knievel is back in his van. He has successfully completed the jump of the 14 buses. Hello again, everyone. I'm Frank Gifford, and it was an exciting afternoon here this afternoon. We were concerned because we frankly did not feel that Evel Knievel was in the condition to make the jump that he said he would make. We'll look at it again. And as you look at the replay, keep in mind, at this point, Evel Knievel almost lost it. The bike almost going over. He hit just over the 14th bus, came down hard, broke the motorcycle, but was able to maintain control and roared out of the exit. So it was a successful jump. And as we have reminded you throughout this entire show, and particularly young people who might ever even consider doing what Evel Knievel has done, keep in mind his own words. He is a professional life risker. He's been doing this all his life. Don't do it. It's dangerous. Evel Knievel himself has been broken many times, over 50 fractures during his daredevil career. Let's go back and look again once more. Evel Knievel tonight will be joined Howard Cosell on Saturday Night Live, visiting with Howard. Also with Howard will be Kate Smith, LaBelle, John Biner, football stars Larry Zonka, Jim Kick. Mason Reese will be back in a special remote from SeaWorld with marathon swimmer Diane Nyad riding Shamu the Killer Swell. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines featuring bicentennial fare vacations to more of your land than any other airline. Come celebrate with United's bicentennial fare.
Exciting adventure tomorrow. First, Carl Robinson battles a sea of quicksand to save Jeremiah on Swiss Family Robinson. Then the $6 million man finds a terrorist missile base tomorrow on ABC.